Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and today Apple released iOS 15 Beta 5. This is available to developers and hopefully very soon to public beta testers. Lately, Apple has been making the public beta available the following day. However, it could be available by the time you're watching this video, but if it's not today, it's usually the day after the developer beta releases. Now, this came in at 1.05 gigabytes. That's on my iPhone 12 Pro Max. It was about a gigabyte or so on the iPhone 11 and 6S Plus that I have it installed on also. Also, along with that, Apple released iPadOS 15 Beta 5 that I have on my 12.9 inch iPad Pro from 2021, and they also released tvOS 15 Beta 5, but they did not yet release watchOS 8 Beta 5 or macOS Monterey Beta 5. For some reason, those versions are not yet available, so I would expect those tomorrow as well. Now let's go ahead and take a look at the build number and talk about what's new. So we'll go to Settings, then we'll go down to General, then About. You can see the build number is 19A5318F. And this particular build does include some nice changes and feature updates, but the first thing they've updated has to do with the modem. There's a modem update, at least on the 12 Pro Max. So hopefully if you were having connectivity issues, I know I was if private relay was turned on, so I turned that feature off, but still occasionally I would have some issues when switching from Wi-Fi to 5G or 4G. So hopefully this resolves that. Now, as far as new features and changes, well, there's quite a few little changes throughout. The first thing is, after the install and it reboots, it actually made me sign in. It gave me the hello screen, and on some of these phones, it made me set up different things. So I had to agree to terms and services on some, on others I didn't. On the iPad, I had to set up Face ID again. So there's something odd when it installs, but that seems to be normal for a lot of people. But when you go to turn off the phone, there's a new message. Now the message was there before, but they changed the way it works. So if we press volume up, volume down, press and hold the power sleep wake button, it now says iPhone findable after power off. We had that before, and then you can click on it or tap on it, and it says iPhone remains findable after power off. You could turn that off, but it'll let you know that that's a possibility. So if you lose your phone, someone takes it, it will now find it. Now we saw this before, but the message was a little bit different. So when you were on the previous version, it didn't show that to you until you powered off the phone and it would show it at the bottom. Now it shows it right at the top with that little message. Now, something else they've updated is if we go into the App Store and we go to an app where we're using a beta version or a test flight version. Now, Test Flight is an app that you can install, and then you can install beta versions of different apps if you're trying them out. And if you have that version installed, the App Store will now tell you that you have a version installed that's a beta and not the public version. So it says view in Test Flight, and then you can see it there. So it's a nice little update to the App Store. Also, they've changed the weather icon. So if we go over to the next page, this is fairly slight, but you can see beta 4 on the left, beta 5 on the right. It's a little bit darker. Here's the weather icon here, and you can see the weather icon on the right phone on beta 5 there. So it's a little bit darker, maybe a little bit more depth as well. A slight change, but just something to note. Now, there's a new feature when it comes to the background sounds. So if you go into your settings, and then we go to accessibility, then we go down to audio/visual, and then we go to background sounds. Under background sounds, we now have the option to stop sounds when locked. This was not an option before. So it says when enabled, background sounds will stop when the iPhone is locked. And thanks to Steve Mosier for helping me find that option. And this is available on beta 5 only. It's not there with beta 4. Now, if we go back to the main screen or the home screen and go into the control center, they've updated the icon for notifications with Siri. So you'll see it here on beta 5 in my right hand, beta 4 in my left hand. It's this icon here under my thumb and here on the right. So there's a new icon, and there's also a new animation if you have AirPods or AirPods Pro connected. So let me connect them so I can show you. And now that they're connected, if I tap on the icon, you'll see there's a little animation when you tap on it now. So it's just a little update. It's made it consistent with what we have on the Apple Watch as well for the same icon. If you slide up from the bottom, you'll have that same icon down here as well. So you can see it there. So it's just a little bit of a consistency update across iOS. Now in iOS 15 beta 5, there's a new option for AirPods. So if we go into our settings and then we go down to accessibility, under accessibility, we go down to AirPods, then we select the AirPods we want, scroll to the bottom. And if you have AirPods Pro that have spatial audio head tracking, there's now an option for off video content or audio and video content. So it works great with video content, but what it tries to do is always make it sound like the audio is coming from your device. If you want that to only happen during video, you can use video. If you want audio and video, that's what the default is. If you want that, you can now select it, which is really nice. Also, something that's very subtle that they updated is the camera icon. So in the previous version, they updated the camera icon slightly. You can see it's missing the shutter button on the left-hand top side of the camera. And they've updated that on beta 5 to match the camera on the lock screen. So it was a little bit different before. They just updated it to match. Very small change, but something to note. Now, when you have a focus mode enabled, notifications are a little bit different. So you can see I have Do Not Disturb turned on. And if we pull down notifications, you'll see it says Notification Center while in Do Not Disturb, and it looks a little different. If we bring over Beta 4, I don't have the summary there, and it is turned on, but the overall look is a little bit different. So they've redesigned that just slightly. Now, they've updated Safari a little bit again. In beta 4, they refined it quite a bit where they changed the bottom bar, and you can see the refresh icon in the bottom address bar. However, they changed this that now when you scroll, the refresh icon goes away. In beta 4, it stays there as you scroll. So here's beta 4 on the left, and again, we have refresh at the bottom where we don't have it in beta 5. So they've changed that a little bit. They've also added a new feature for color in the top and bottom tab bar. So if we go home, go to our settings, then our Safari settings. At the bottom, you'll see prior to beta 5, it said show color in tab bar. In beta 5, it says show color in top and bottom bars. So they've made that change just a little bit. So that's something new. Now, Safari has a slight update on iPad as well. So I wanted to show you that. Now, on the iPad, if we go to Safari, in Safari, you can see that the address bar now has an outline around it. And I'm using the more traditional tab style that they have, and now some of the shading is a little bit different in the tabs. So that has been updated as well. So nothing really big compared to beta 4, but they have refined it a little bit more. Also, if we go into the Safari settings, where we have the option to switch between a compact tab bar and separate tab bar, these were not showing properly before when you were in light mode versus dark mode. So it would show like it did with light mode before, and this would stay just like that when you switched to dark mode. So now it's showing properly. Also on the iPad, if we go to our home screen options, under home screen options, we now have the option to use large icons. So if we switch, you'll see the icons are sort of huge now. We can switch back and forth just with that little button there. And also, some people have said that they really appreciate now that they've allowed you to fill in this space a little bit better. So if I'm in portrait mode, we have 4x6. If we go to the next screen here, we have 5x6. So we can fully fill in this space now where some people were not able to do that before. So it's a little bit better as far as that. Again, 5x6 on this page. So it's nice that we're able to do that. I know a lot of people were not able to fill this bottom bar. Some people were, it looks like, but a lot of people were not able to. Now, unfortunately, there's still no mention of universal control. Originally, it was in the beta 4 notes. They removed it, and it's not in the beta 5 notes. So if we go into settings under general and then go to airplay and handoff, let me change to light mode so there's less of a reflection, and we turn off handoff, turn it back on, you'll see there's an option for cursor and keyboard. We had this before, but still there's no option for universal control where we can use a mouse from our Mac on this device and then just drag it seamlessly across to your Mac back and forth. So that's not yet activated. Now, there's a few splash screens when we go into different apps as well. So the first time you go into Photos, you'll get a splash screen that looks like this, where it says what's new in Photos. It says shared with you, memories, and richer info. So that's new. There's also a new splash screen the first time you open podcasts. And I just took screenshots of all of these since I was looking for these new features. So it just says shared with you as far as what's new in Apple Podcasts. There's also another one the first time you open Maps that says interactive globe, all new city experience, immersive walking directions. And then another one when you open the Home app. So if you open Home, it says Home Keys, Siri enabled accessories, HomeKit secure video. Now, some people are seeing new ones when they open Translate for the first time. Now, I saw this, but it didn't look any different than what I had on beta 4. But if we go into Translate, we'll go down to Translate here. And if we open Apple's Translate app, you'll see there's a new splash screen that says conversation views, auto translate, and system-wide translation. And then finally, there's another one if you go into the TV app for the first time. So if we go to TV, Again, we should get a splash screen that talks about Apple Originals and Apple TV channels. So this is getting ready for the public release, where it's going to tell you all about those apps if you've never been in them and what's new about them. So that's what's new in iOS 15 Beta 5. Now, according to Apple, also in their notes with Beta 5, legacy contacts have been removed in Beta 5, but will be re-added a little bit later. Also, there's no mention in the notes of CSAM photo detection, so that's something maybe they'll enable later on or closer to the time of final release. Also, when it comes to known issues and resolved issues, there's only one resolved issue that's mentioned in their notes that has to do with audio playback functioning properly after you restart your device. So sometimes the speakers wouldn't work right on the iPad or the iPhone. That should now be resolved. If you're having that issue, restart your device. It should no longer be an issue, but it should be resolved in this update. Also, one thing I noticed is that AirPod connectivity seems to be a little bit better when switching between devices. When I installed the update after I had installed it, when I was looking for new features going from my iPhone to my iPad, it seemed to immediately switch, which I thought was pretty impressive and seems much better than what it was before. However, there are still 31 known issues that are listed in the Apple notes. And while they're aware of these and still working on them, some of the bugs have to do with CarPlay issues with sharing your screen. And also, some people are having issues with VoiceOver. Maybe the speech is going away. Also, some VPNs are not working. And me personally, I'm having Twitter crash the first time I open it. It sort of goes to a blank screen and then just crashes. So those are all known issues. However, when it comes to green tint, I did ask people on Twitter if they're still having it, and I hadn't had a single person that says they have it. Some people say it's a hardware issue, but Apple did fix this when it came to iPhone 11 Pro and 11 Pro Max. They released an update in late August, so maybe we'll see something like that. Now, as far as overall battery life, I've been using this as my main phone, and I can show you Beta 5 just briefly. My battery health is now down to 95%. That went down to 95% before this video, and that's pretty typical for this age of a phone. Usually after 1 year, you'll be down to about 90%. 2 years is 80%. And that's Apple's benchmark. So 80% after 2 years is normal. It's not caused by the update. It's just rather the battery degrading over time. It happens to all batteries. Now you can see here's my battery life. Depending on the day, it really varies. But a couple days ago, I had 2 hours and 47 minutes of screen on time, 3 hours and 38 minutes of screen off time, and used about 50% of my battery. Depending on the day, it varied as I was using different applications and checking things out. So it varies greatly. You'll see today I've used it for 3 hours and 7 minutes and had 1 hour and 38 minutes of screen off time, and I'm still not at 50%. So maybe 40%. Meaning if we double that to 80 or 100, we could get about 7 or 8 hours of screen on time. Now that we have Beta 5 installed, I would expect this to go up. As we're getting closer to later betas, I would expect the battery life to hopefully improve a little bit over time. Now, as far as overall performance, so far using this, I did notice it seemed to be very smooth. Geekbench scores don't really show that, but it seems to be very smooth, and just scrolling through things seems to be pretty decent overall. I haven't really had any issues with this. I did notice that on initial startup, the iPhone 6S Plus was quite slow, but it seems to be performing okay now. So if we go into music, this is the first time I've gone into music on here, so you can see with me in real time. Scrolling is quite smooth. Usually this stutters quite a bit. And just going to browse, again, it's smooth, and just going between different apps. So it seems to be okay, but that initial load did make the phone a little bit slow. Now let's take a look at the Geekbench scores. So if we go into Geekbench 5, we'll go over to Geekbench 5, wherever I've put it here. There we go. And we'll go to the benchmarks. And these scores are a little bit low on the 12 Pro Max. 1,589 for single core, 3,731 for multi-core. I actually ran it 2 times. And as you can see here at the top, we have today's scores, and July 27th with Beta 4 was a little bit higher. So despite it being a little bit lower, maybe it will speed up later on, it does feel plenty fast. Now this could be an issue with Geekbench or something they've changed in the background, but it seems to be performing okay just using it, but the numbers don't really show that. Now let's take a look at all of these devices. Now from left to right, I have the 12.9-inch iPad Pro from 2021, then the iPhone 6S Plus, then the iPhone 11, and then the iPhone 12 Pro Max. And I did run it twice on the 6S Plus and 11 to get the best score. So this is the best I could get so far. They could improve over the next few days, but this would give you a general idea of what to expect. Now, should you install iOS 15 beta 5? Well, I would say if you're on the beta program already, absolutely. It's generally our duty to install them, try it out. We're getting the software early so we can try it out and then report feedback to Apple. They sent out emails requesting people join the beta, and I would say it's probably fairly stable enough at this point to try it out. However, if you don't have a computer and a backup to go back if you need to, I might skip this. As long as you know what's involved, maybe you'll have crashes and bugs here and there, like I have Twitter crashing from time to time. If that's not a big deal and you can report it in feedback, then I would absolutely try it out. Again, if you're on the beta program already, I would definitely install it. Now, as far as when to expect beta 6, well, I think we're going to be on a week-by-week schedule, at least for the next couple of weeks. Generally in August, based off previous years with iOS 14, iOS 13, iOS 12, in August, we always get to a weekly schedule. So I would expect next Tuesday and then the following Tuesday. So beta 6, beta 7, then a release candidate, and then a final release somewhere in mid-September to late September. So based on what they're doing there, I would expect that. Also, recently found in a database, they saw iOS 14.8, so they'll have to fit that in somewhere, as it does look like they're working on it. So maybe we'll have that sometime in late August as well, or maybe they'll run two at the same time, although that would be very unusual. Now, if you've found any other features, I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. And of course, if you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, I'll link it in the description like I normally do. If you haven't subscribed already though, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.